Hey guys, Whiskey McNair here, and let's kind of get some of these icons out of the way. So today it's just going to be a vlog, and obviously it's not going to be monetized because this is something that's very personal and something I feel I should talk about because I went through it, and there's not a lot of awareness surrounded by it. So today I want to talk about child abuse and PTSD, and not just about child abuse right then and there, but how it kind of affects and develops afterwards. So I guess I should start with giving a little bit of backstory on myself and my own experiences. So I was born into captivity, I guess you could say, as long as I can remember. I was always being beaten or watching my mom get beat, or things getting smashed, plates smashing in the kitchen, my stuff being broken for whatever reason. And my biological father was a bipolar manic depressive schizophrenic. So of course you got a very bad melting pot of mental illness right there. And to make it worse, I lived in the very small town of Hamilton, Alabama. So we were kind of on the outskirts of this little town. So we weren't even in the town itself. We were on the outskirts. And we lived in a double-wide trailer in the woods, basically. So we were cut off from civilization. We had like two neighbors, and they never came over. They never interacted. They did their own thing. Everyone was a hermit out there. So there was very little chance of even escaping on foot if you had to. And I mean to the nearest gas station, it was at least 2 or 3 miles. You know? So it was very, I was trapped. My mom was trapped. There wasn't a lot we could do. And my dad was so controlling and paranoid, you know, because of the things he did to us. He would get into so much trouble, so he put a lockdown. We had a computer, but all computer activity was monitored by him. All phone calls were monitored by him. The second anything seemed wrong, the phone cable was gonna get yanked out of the wall, and there was going to be a horrible beating involved afterwards. Every day I woke up, I was wondering if today is going to be the day that I die. Is today going to be the day that my mom doesn't wake up? Is today going to be that day where everything goes wrong? Very rarely was there a good day. So I would wake up, I'd get out of bed, I'd play with my toys. You know, I was homeschooled. I didn't go to school. My dad didn't work. He was on disability and welfare, and we got food stamps. So my mom wasn't allowed to work. I wasn't allowed to go to school. I was homeschooled, and he didn't go to work. So we were around him 24/7 at all times. So there was no escape. There was no searching for help. We were cut off from all other sides of the family. We weren't allowed to talk to anyone. It was complete captivity. There was no way out. All hope was lost. And if we had any hope at all, it was beaten out of us. And for me, at least as a kid, it wasn't even brainwashing at that point, because I was born into this. I didn't know what was normal. I didn't know, I mean, because it was all negative and it was all bad, I knew it was wrong. I knew everything that happening was way wrong and way fucked up, but I didn't know anything else. You know, I hardly ever saw family outside of that. I didn't even know I had uncles, really. Except for one. There was one uncle I never knew about or never met until I was like 10 or 11 years old. So some mornings I would wake up and I would be awoken by hearing my mom scream and cry no, and glasses and plates being smashed onto the kitchen floor, and just being so young and so small, you just lock up. With you're helpless. What are you going to do to stop it? Can you stop it? If you can't stop it, how bad are you going to get it? Are you going to die? Is he going to take your life? What do you do? I mean, you're 6 or 7 years old hearing all of this and wanting it to stop and wanting to stop it. And you feel guilty for not acting upon it. You feel guilty for not moving. So you hate yourself because there's nothing you can do. And you hate yourself even more because you're too frozen and petrified to try. Because you know the pain that's going to happen. You've been beaten time after time again. So many, many mornings were like that. It was a daily thing. And my dad didn't drink, or my biological father, he didn't drink. He didn't really smoke cigarettes or anything like that. He just smoked a lot of marijuana. And, I mean, that hasn't affected my view on marijuana, but he had medicine specifically to control the bipolar and schizophrenic, which also, these various medicines also helped with the manic depressive. I would have preferred him to be fucking manic depressive all the time than bipolar and schizophrenic. But it made him normal for the period of time that it lasted in his system. Once the THC wore off, he was him again. And then he was mad that he didn't have it. So he's the only person I've ever known to be addicted mentally to pot. And the only reason he had this addiction to pot was because pot temporarily kept his emotions and mental stability in control. It contained it. But once it wore off, it was a shitstorm after that. So when he ran out of pot, it was bad. It was very, very bad. Because then the only thing on his mind was to get high again, so he didn't feel what he was feeling, so he didn't think what he was thinking. And this is a guy who had spiral notebook after spiral notebook, just like the butterfly effect, the movie with Ashton Kutcher. He had a shit ton of these journals where he wrote down his fucked up sadistic thoughts, you know, because he was schizophrenic. He'd heard voices. We don't know how true that was, but based on how fucking insane he was, he heard voices. So he'd write down these voices in the journal. And from what I can remember, some of those were like to kill us. Some of the voices, he said the voices were the ones that told him to do the things that he did. I don't think that's completely true. I think it's somewhat of the very out of control bipolar, you know, kind of making him overreact and lash out. But he was aware that he had control over us. He was aware that it was going to be a desperate, desperate attempt if we tried to escape. And he was there always, so he didn't hesitate to beat the shit out of us. He didn't hesitate to threaten to kill us because there was nothing we could do about it. So aside from waking up in the morning to horrible, horrible sounds, there would be nights that he would come into my room and sit down next to my bed as I was trying to go to sleep and flip the lights on, and with a straight face, as calmly and nonchalantly as he could say it, would tell me that he was going to go into their bedroom and kill my mom. Then he was going to come in while I was sleeping and kill me in my sleep, and then he was going to kill himself. And he told me not to worry because I wasn't going to feel a thing. And then he would get up and leave and say nothing afterwards. So I would just have my window cracked just in case. But again, being 7 or 8 years old, I'm sitting there at night thinking about escaping, but on the other hand, being terrified that he was going to kill my mom. So I'd be crying myself to sleep, but not be able to sleep, because I want to live and escape, but I don't want to lose my mom. I mean, this severely fucks you up mentally, because you're always in this struggle of, I want to save my own life, but what's he going to do to my mom? So that happens day in and day out. And at a certain point, even as a kid, you sort of lose that sensation. It desensitizes you from life and death. Because there's many nights where you're assuming, okay, if I slip away and I go to sleep, I'm going to die tonight. He's going to kill us. And at a certain point, you become numb. You're just so numb because you're kind of scared, but at the same time, you're not scared to die anymore. Because, I mean, the more and more you're forced to think about death, the more and more you do. And you start thinking, you know, maybe it's going to be sweet because I won't have to deal with this anymore. There's only so many nights you can pray that things will get better, and so many mornings you wake up and things are worse than they were. So there was struggles with faith. There was struggles with life and death. There was struggles between staying sane and losing it completely. There was a lot going on. So, I mean, one of the easiest accessible memories that I still have, because there's a lot of things that I just blocked out, you know, I guess I have dreams sometimes about some of these memories, but then when I wake up, I can't really tell if they were real anymore, because a lot of it just, it got contained once I finally left. Once I got away, it finally, like, it just blocked out a bunch of shit as I was growing older and stored it away somewhere in my subconscious. But one of my the memories I can access the easiest, I had a Game Boy Color and Pokemon Blue, and that was my life, because whenever anything happened, whenever shit got really bad, I would just play the Game Boy and try to separate myself from reality. You know, just do my damnedest to pretend that I wasn't there anymore, that I was in the game. But my mom had talked to her brother, I believe, her brother or my grandpa, and she said something that I guess was a red flag to him. And he ripped the phone out of the wall and began to beat her with it. And then began to beat her. And I could hear the sounds of him hitting her in the chest and her voice along with it. And I began to shake. And I was just staring at the Game Boy, shaking and frozen and petrified, and that sinking dense feeling in my stomach again as he continued on until it was finally over, just tears streaming out of my face, but unable to have an expression. I was terrified. I was numb. I was depressed. I was angry. I had thought about killing my father. And when you're 9 years old and you're seriously thinking about killing your father, that's another level of fucked up. Because at that age, he's still your dad. As much as you hate his guts, as much as you know he's a monster, that he's barely a human being, it's just so dark. And then you begin to, once it passes, you know, once you realize you're too scared to even do it, then you have all these other self-reflecting thoughts. Like, one, I'm thinking about taking my father's life. What the fuck's wrong with me? And then two, why can't I do it? It's going to save my mom. Why can't I do it? What the fuck's wrong with me? So you're just, you hate yourself. You hate him and you hate yourself almost equally. We finally got away when I was 10. He took a shower. My mom finally mustered the courage to email her friend who called my grandma. My grandma called the cops. And just thank God my prayers were finally answered. And we were taken away and we were put into a... I'm not going to disclose the location or any details, but it's a safe house for women and children. I won't say where. You know, it's for families in this circumstance. Families who are beaten, abused, tortured, and the kids are all fucked up in the head. All, each and every one. There's not a single normal kid in that facility. They're all really fucked up or worse. But that's my backstory. But I met a lot of kids growing up. They didn't get it as bad as I did, but the damage was still there. They still went through the same sort of fucked up scenarios. And as you grow older, it doesn't go away. It gets better. You know, you learn how to talk to people. You learn how to cope with it a little, but it doesn't completely go away. Which is also why I want to talk about PTSD. Now, PTSD, you know, post-traumatic stress disorder, it's only soldiers, you know, people who've been in war and had to deal with that intensity. Most people only know of soldiers getting it, but that's not entirely true. Any person can get PTSD from a traumatic experience or a variety of traumatic experiences. So, and those, if you're watching and you went through these sort of situations, if you lived in fear every day, if you were beaten. Now, I'm not talking about you just got your butt whooped with a belt because you did something bad. I'm talking about your mom or dad took that belt just because you spilled milk on the carpet and bent you over a couch, took your clothes off, and beat you from head to toe until you were purple. There's a very, very big difference from discipline and severe abuse. So if you've gone through that, and you've gone through that for a very long period of time, I'm sure you can relate to having nightmares, to having triggers. Some of you and me too, are still so fucked up that if anyone raises their voice at us or yells at us, we immediately get a fight or flight. If someone threatens us, if you were at school after you got out of this situation, or if you were still in this situation, if you were at school and a kid threatened to beat you up and you just went, everything went red or everything went black, or you're just immediate adrenaline because you gotta take this shit. You took this shit for years and you're not gonna feel helpless again. You're not gonna let anybody make you feel that way again. So you're going to go over the top. I found that a lot of the kids that were like me, or a lot of the teens, and some of them now that are adults, we all have the same problem. And that's, it could be a small situation where any other person would just go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and they wouldn't get any angrier or overreact past that level. But for a lot of us, they start with a 1 or 2 and we jump to 8 or we jump to 10. You know, we're gonna nip it in the bud right there. It's not going any farther than this. We took this shit for years. We're never gonna feel this way again. So it has an effect on your relationships later on. It has an effect on your friendships, because your significant other is not necessarily going to do the things that your parents did to you. Your friends aren't going to do the things your parents did to you. They're not going to beat you down. They're not going to attempt to take your life. They're not going to do the things that, you know, but you can't, it's hard to control, because for however many years you dealt with that, you just had to be completely prepared for the worst. You had to go over the top, because that's what was happening to you. That person was going way over the top. I mean, they were taking it to the extreme, so you had to be prepared for the extreme. So then once you're finally free, you go and interact with at least halfway normal people, and they're not going to go to the extreme. But your natural instinct is to expect the extreme. So it's taken many, many years. It's taken me 13 years to attempt to balance myself out, and I've had to study normal people, and I've done it ever since I went to public school. From being homeschooled, is I studied people, like in my head, like I'd watch how people interact with each other and what they say, and just tried to find the most normal people I could find and see how they react to these situations and what they do, and then compare what I'm feeling then with how they handled it. So I'd compare and contrast, because I knew I wasn't normal. The things that I went through make me react a very different way, make me just go to the top immediately from a small point. And a lot of people would say this is bipolar. It may be. I may be bipolar. I went and got, I didn't have a full mental evaluation, but believe me, I've seen children's psychiatrists, therapists, counselors. I've seen them all. I've had prescriptions before for like ADHD medication and stuff that I just stopped taking, because one of them was Strattera. I didn't do any better at schoolwork. The only difference was it made me too tired to be active. I was just a zombie. Like, I'd go to PE and walk everywhere because I didn't have the energy to do anything. I didn't have the energy to play, so I just stopped taking it. It wasn't helping me. I still felt the same. It just took all of my energy away. It was a sleeping pill, basically, to get me through the day without any hyperactivity. But I learned my own coping mechanisms. I learned small habits to draw my attention away. You know, everyone has ADD. Everyone has ADHD. But you don't need pills. Like, I have habits that got me through school. I had to find these habits. I had to test things. But if I shake my leg and I move my leg, it pulls the energy away and I can focus on schoolwork. If I take my shirt and rub it under my fingernail, it distracts some of that energy and I can focus. Like, I have all of these habits that I learned to keep me calm and to control my anxiety so that I can get through life. And I don't need pills, because I know how to trick my brain. I know how to work it. Anyway, I'm getting off track. So I had to study other kids growing up, and I had to study other people to sort of get an example of what normal is and what normal reactions to situations are. And it's been a huge hurdle for me, and I know it's still a huge hurdle for many people out there. There's some people in their late 20s who went through some of the things I went through, maybe even more severe, that they still have huge problems with not being defensive, with not overreacting, and, you know, just immediately wanting to fight and to avoid it, because the anxiety of a conflict is just so bad because what they went through. But if you look at PTSD and you look at triggers, that's like veterans, they say not to shoot fireworks off around veterans because it's a trigger. It'll be a flashback. Because they were out in warfare and they heard guns and cannons and bombs and explosions, it triggers their PTSD. their anxiety goes up. They have episodes, you know, flashbacks. Well, for kids who were abused very badly in their childhood, and they heard screaming and smashing of plates and things like that, when they get older, or even then, they have PTSD triggers too. And I was diagnosed with PTSD, as was my mom. She also has PTSD triggers. There's also things that trigger her anxiety very bad. So if someone raises their voice at me and they get confrontational, I'll jump to 8, but I'll have to bring myself down from 8. Because immediately I'm trying to outdo them. I'm trying to go over the top. If they get a 5, I'm going to be a 8. If they get an 8, I'm going to be a 20. I'm going to overpower them so that I don't have to worry about the conflict. I'm not going to be a victim. I'm not going to be helpless. But that's not good. It's good to stand up for yourself, but when you're going to that extent, it's not good. It's not healthy, because you're going to deal with these conflicts all the time, and you can't react that way all the time, because you'll go to jail. You know, if you're constantly threatening somebody or threatening to take their life because of a smaller threat or confrontation, you're going to go to jail. You're going to face charges. You can't live like that. And it's draining. It's so draining for you to live that way. And then once the fight's over and you've already said horrible, horrible things, then you're guilty and you're starting to hate yourself again, because why did I say that? Why did I do that? Now you're anxious and the fight's over. So knowing that you have a sort of PTSD and you have a trigger, knowing that and studying people is the best way I've found in my life to keep from feeling these feelings, to keep from destroying and burning bridges and ruining all of my relationships. Because I've made very poor decisions. I can just go back and look at messages that I had from past relationships now and realize, oh my God, I was a crazy person. I was insane. Why did I say those things? Why? No wonder they left me. And I've gotten to a point where I'm not defensive anymore. I just accept my faults. I mean, it's hard. I know it's, especially when you have your guard up all the time and you're one of those people that says there's nothing wrong with me, it's them. Well, I used to think I was special, but I'm just another guy. I'm just another human being on this planet. I'm not special. There's people out there that think the same thoughts I think. There's people out there who have come up with the same ideas, that have done the same things I've done. You're not the only one. You know, your shit doesn't smell any better than anyone else's. So you have to look at yourself that way and put your guard down and admit fault. Even though it's hard, even though it might be extremely hurtful to admit that you've done something wrong, you have to, because that's the best step to take to get better. You have to admit that, yes, I was crazy. Yes, I was in the wrong. I couldn't realize it then, but I was the one in the wrong. I can't blame them anymore. It was my fault. There's no way of changing what I've done in the past, but I can move forward. I can, the next relationship I have, I'll just go over what I did before and see everything that I clearly did wrong. And that, you know, if I was too jealous, if I was too controlling, that was wrong. This is the reason this person left me. And it could very well be the reason that the next person will. So that has to change. You know, I realize that I have issues. I mean, I realized it a long time ago, but being such a child before, even well into 18 or 19, being just such a child, I wasn't willing to look at myself and see that I did everything wrong. I was defensive. I pointed fingers at everyone else, and it hurt me. every single day because I was trapped in conflict. But it wasn't until I realized I was in the wrong and I admitted to it that it sort of helped me release these demons that I had. It helped me to deal with the anger, to deal with the rage, that instant rage, because it would just be a switch. Someone would threaten me, or someone would say something, or if I was in a relationship and the other person dared to say something back to me, I'd go over the top. But you can't always be the one who wins in a relationship. You can't be the one who gets the last word all the time. Because how would you feel to lose every fight? How would you feel to lose every conversation and confrontation? How would you feel to lose every time, to always be wrong and they're always right? You hate it. Everyone hates that. You win some, you lose some. You give and you take. If you always win, then you're not going to stay with somebody. And they're not going to stay with you. So I guess a big side effect of child abuse for a lot of, and there's different spectrums. There's some people who came out of child abuse who are timid in nature, and they don't get that immediately, I'm going to conquer. They just sort of implode. They give in. They cave. And that's also bad for a different reason, because you have to stand up for yourself, but you have to find a balance. So there's got to be a lot of introspection. There's got to be a lot of looking at yourself and saying, what is good for me and what's not? What's a normal reaction to a situation and what's not? See, if you're too overbearing and the second you're faced with a confrontation, you just want to overpower it and conquer it and you want to come out on top, you're probably going to do that with regular day-to-day human interaction. You're going to do that with disagreements. You're going to do that with arguments. And if you're the other side, you're just going to cave in all the time. And you're going to start to hate yourself because you're caving. Because you're not standing up for yourself. You're going to feel helpless and you're going to feel weak. So if you've been abused, either if you're the conquering or you're the caving, you have to come to a middle ground. You have to really assess what's most important to you that you're not going to put up with. Okay? So if you're the caver and there's something the person says to you that insults and hurts you and you're sick of hearing it, if it's that important to you, if it's making you that self-conscious, you stand up for yourself. If it's important to you, you stand up for it. If the person in that relationship, be friendship or significant other, won't stop, then you leave. Because you have to look into the future. This is going to continue to make me feel this way. It's going to continue to trigger me in either anger or depression. So I'm going to be either up or down. And I want to be in the middle, at least most days. I want to feel good about myself. So that's something you can't put up with. All right? If you're the very angry sort, then what you're going to have to work on, since you already stand up for yourself for everything, and that's me, is you're going to have to work on picking your battles. Like, if someone says something stupid, or if they don't want to do what you want to do, is it that important to you? How important is it to you? Is it so important that you can't be with that person? Because if not, let it go. Because you don't always have to win. Let them win some battles. They need it just as much as you do. And if you've been continuing this poisonous relationship, they need it more than you do. So, other than the interactions and learning to control your reactions and your moods, there's also another issue with kids that have been abused, and it's the self-hatred, the denials, the flashbacks, the memories. Looking back on these memories, I should have done this differently. I should have helped my mom when she was being beaten. I shouldn't have let this occur. But you have to realize and assess, was there actually something you could do? And how would that have played out? So say you're upset because you didn't do anything. What could you have done to actually stop them from doing what they did? Kill them? Well, how's that gonna go? If I would have killed my dad, here's how that would have played out. Cops are gonna show up. They may say it was self-defense, but guess what? I'm going to the psych ward. I'm going to the psych ward because I was a 8 to 9 year old kid who murdered his father. Yeah, I'm gonna be in a mental hospital for a while. And what's that gonna do to my mom? All right. She watched her kid murder somebody. Right there, that's another level of fucked up just for your mom. Two, how is she gonna cope with having to visit you in a mental hospital? And now she's completely alone. She didn't need your dad around, of course, but she needed you around. Because she needed support too. Because she's on the verge of ending up in that mental hospital herself, and you're not around. Now she has to go visit you through rooms that are, you know, closely secured to make sure that you don't snap. So if you would have done something that extreme, if you would have done something about it, you could have just made matters worse. So you need to let that go. All right? Because I don't know if I believe everything happens for a reason. At this point in my life, I kind of believe that things just happen. And once they happen, once a decision is made, it keeps moving on based off of that decision. That's what I believe. I don't really know if everything happens for a reason, because sometimes some very fucked up things happen and nothing good comes of it. Sometimes there are people that are killed and nothing good comes out of it. No change is made. What's a good example of that? Vietnam. We didn't change anything. A lot of people on their side and a lot of people on our side were killed. What happened? Was there a revolution? No. Even the hippies in Woodstock, nothing changed it. Nothing changed Vietnam. We just killed a bunch of people, and a lot of our people were killed as well for no reason. There was no purpose. That's a good example, I think, of general life. It happens or it doesn't happen. If it does happen, then there's pros and cons. There's consequences and there's benefits. But you can't look back and ask if you can change anything or what would have happened if it happened differently, because it didn't. It didn't happen. And if it did happen, you could have just made matters worse. But if you got out of it, if whoever else got out of it with you, now you have to move on. It's over now. The memories and the scars, they're gonna be with you forever. Unfortunately, there's nothing we can do about those. You're still gonna have those memories. You can just try your damnedest to dwell on them less. And if you have a child, like I have a son that's about to be 2 now, it was a lifesaver. Because for so long I felt like I had no purpose. And I was just supposed to walk around harboring these horrible, sick memories, wondering if I could change anything, if it meant anything, if there was any purpose to it. And now that I have a son, now I have a chance to make sure he doesn't ever feel that again. Now, I know what the extreme is. I know where the line is in discipline. I know what will fuck him up mentally and what will give him support and stability. because I know where the extreme goes. I know how deep it feels. I know how much of those childhood memories you carry with you when they're traumatic enough. So I won't repeat the mistakes that my father made, because I know how it feels, and that gives me purpose. I have a chance to create and shape a human being that will never feel the way I feel, that will never have the memories I have, that will never experience the pain that I deal with, and that I will continue to deal with for years. And it does ease my mind. It does ease the pain a little bit. Because now when I remember, now when I have those dreams, I think of my son. And now it's not so much negative, but it's positive, because it's a roadmap to where I don't want to go. So if you've experienced these things, if you carry these demons with you, don't let the demons drag you down. It's going to take a hell of a lot of work. And I'm not going to say you need to go see a therapist and it's going to fix all your problems, because it's not going to fix all of them. It'll help. They might be able to offer you coping mechanisms. They might be able to offer some insight. But those pills, they're just going to make you numb. It's going to take a hell of a lot of effort. It's going to take a lot of strength. It's not going to be easy. It's going to be very hard. But don't give up. Just keep fighting those demons. Because if you do, if you put in effort, if you don't take the easy way would be killing yourself or taking pills. That's easy. It's not hard. It's hard on everyone else around you. It's not hard on you. But if you work for it, if you work for fixing those problems, if you work for breaking those mental habits that you make, if you work, just put in your best effort in your relationships to make yourself a person that you would be able to be around, then you will be rewarded with love and support. You will be rewarded by knowing that after everything you went through, after the horrible, horrible things that you deal with every day inside of yourself, that you're still able to function better than most other people, that you're still able to have healthy relationships, that you're still able to make it through life. Even though it's hard work, you didn't give up. You didn't let that person beat you for good. You're still fighting. After all those years, you're still fighting. And you're winning. So don't give up. Give it your all every day. At least one day a week, take time for yourself to go somewhere alone and sit and look at everything around you and just be grateful. It's going to take a hell of a lot of work to deal with the shit that we've gone through. But we can do it. Because we survived. We didn't die. We weren't broken completely. We were broken many times, but we weren't broken completely. We're still alive today after the shit we went through. Even though they're still in the back of our minds, we survived once, we can keep on surviving. And we'll be a living testament that when they wanted to break us, they failed time and time again. So that's all I got for this video. I just really wanted to give some insight and help any way I could, because I know there was many times I wanted to end it all. There was many times I wanted to give in. There was many, many, many times I was just dwelling and soaking in self-hatred. hating myself for a number of reasons that I shouldn't even have hated myself for. And it's been such a long journey, and it still is. But I got through some of the worst days. And I hope this helps you, whoever you are, whatever you went through. You're not alone. There's a lot of us. And I just wish you the best. And if any of you see this and you just need somebody to talk to, I'll put my Twitter in the link. I won't necessarily do Facebook because that'll fill up too quickly. Unfortunately for me, I'm not very popular on Twitter, so I'll be able to see more of your messages. If there's anyone who wants to reach out, if you're feeling like taking your own life, of course call the suicide hotline, but I've done that before and they weren't very enthusiastic and they didn't sound like they cared. It sounded like they were reading a piece of paper. But if you're thinking about ending it all, message me. It's Whiskey McNair at Twitter. I've been there. I've been in the hospital. I've been in that room where they check your pockets, lock the door, and there's no TV. I've suffered minor kidney damage. I've come close a few times. And I'm never doing it again. So, I know this was a darker video, but I just hope I can help. Because I would hate for any more people to continue to just feel this helplessness. I don't want any of you to feel helpless again. But we have to have control. We can't sink too low and we can't go overboard. But take it easy, guys. Have a good one. Drink responsibly. Stay strong.